Okay, good morning. My name is Alvin Fox, and I'm in the Pathology, Microbiology, and Immunology department, and today we begin the Bacteriology course section of the course. There are two components. I want to explain a little bit before I get into the lectures. There are two components to bacteriology. We call basic bacteriology and clinical bacteriology. Basic bacteriology is concerned with the emphasis on the bacterial cell itself, what makes bacteria bacteria, and how we sort of tell one from another, and some of their physiological, biochemical, genetic features. And the clinical part of the course there are two ways you could handle things. One way you could handle it on a disease-based organization. Some textbooks do that. Most do it on the basis of the organism. And that's the approach that we use. We cover the organism and the disease associated with them rather than grouping diseases and grouping the organisms with the diseases. Now, the way that this is set up is to make this easier for you. I strongly suggest you do this. If you don't, you're just making hard work for yourselves. Is I am not going to be repetitive, and none of us are in the clinical part. And basically, we're making assumptions in the clinical part that you already have, you remember the stuff from the basic bacteriology. That there are certain things that we've said about bacteria in general that apply, particularly the feature things associated with an organism being gram-positive or gram-negative. We don't have time in a short period of time that we have to repeat everything that we say over and over and over again. So when you go through the basic part of the course and you learn those first few lectures, you need to take those principles and apply it to the individual organisms as we go through them. Okay? That's not a request, that's a requirement. Otherwise, you want what we're talking about. It's as simple as that. Okay? So that's the way we're set up. And that's not just with my lectures, it's all of the clinical bacteriology, which starts with the general aspects of pathogenesis, which is lecture 41 through till the end of the bacteriology section, which is 55. Okay, so I'm going to begin now with the bacterial cell. In my lectures, everybody's got a different way of doing things. What I've chosen to do is to give you a list of keywords, and the keywords cover most of the points that, all the major points that we're going to cover during the lecture. And so it's useful also that when you go through to sort of see if you know what these terms mean, to give you an idea of what you've taken it in when you're going through this on your own. You are responsible for both the PowerPoint presentation and the Word handout. They're not identical. There are a lot more pictures in the PowerPoint presentation and less words. There's more explanation in the PowerPoint. I don't cover every word that's in the Word handout. So you're responsible for both, okay? But they're designed to be complementary. The PowerPoint's supposed to help you with the Word part. Some people deal better with pictures, some people deal better with words, so you get the advantage of getting it both ways. Okay, so let's go through the list briefly. Let's see what we've got here. All right, so we're going to be covering with, overall features of what a general description of bacteria and what makes bacteria bacteria. We're going to cover all the components of bacteria. The terms gram stain and gram negative, gram positive are going to come up over and over and over again in different contexts, and they mean all sorts of things. You'll understand over the next few lectures what those things are. We're going to cover the outside of the bacteria as well as the inside. Then we're going to cover some unique aspects of particular types of bacteria, and we're going to cover some of the things that are not part of the cell envelope, the outside as such, but are associated with it. And we'll briefly touch on the unique aspect, the bacterial spore, but we'll get into more detail on that later. Okay, so to begin with, those of you, in high schools, it's still not uncommon to teach things, taxonomy, the classification of the different life forms on this planet, in terms of plants and animals. And that sort of notion was discarded a long time ago. Indeed, there was a Nobel Prize awarded for this very thing that we're looking at here. So I'm sorry, you know, this is not high school. If you remember plants and animals from high school, forget it. You know, we're in med school now, and this is a bacteriology class. Okay, basically, life is broken down into two, on this planet, is broken into cellular forms of life, are broken down into two things, prokaryotic and eukaryotic. The prokaryotic forms of cells are the bacteria. And there are really two different types of bacteria, and I'll get more into that in a second. These are different kingdoms. They're actually, it's referred to as the three kingdoms. This is one kingdom, the eukaryotic kingdom, and these are the other two kingdoms within the prokaryotes. So straight away you understand how important bacteria are, because bacteria are worth two kingdoms, and everything else on this planet, including human beings, are worth one kingdom. Okay, so that's an important place to begin, to understand how important bacteria are. Okay, so we have prokaryotic or prokaryotes, prokaryotic cells, and eukaryotic cells, everything else. The everything else includes fungi, and I do stress that because it may not come up again. But when you have the mycology part of the course and are dealing with fungi, those are eukaryotic cells. When you deal with the parasitology part of the course, actually I think you may have had that already, I'm not sure that things get swapped around. Yes, you've had the parasitology. But anyway, those are eukaryotic cells. Human cells are eukaryotic cells. Everything you covered in immunology is eukaryotic, and it's got not an awful and it's a lot to do with bacteria in terms of pathogenesis, but not their structures. Okay, so prokaryotes and eukaryotes. The prokaryotes are sometimes referred to as bacteria. Terms get a little bit confusing, but the concepts are quite simple. The true bacteria, or eubacteria, is what we're interested in this, or what you'll be interested in the rest of your lives, because you can't get away from bacteria. You're constantly going to be seeing patients who have bacterial infections. Eubacteria, true bacteria, are human pathogens or opportunists. They can be clinical, that is to say found isolated from patients, or they can be found in the environment. One kingdom. That's the eubacter, another term, the true bacteria, sometimes just called bacteria in italics. The archaea, on the other hand, are under the microscope, may not look much different, but genetically and biochemically, they are quite different from the eubacter. These organisms are environmental organisms. You essentially never see a case of a human infection caused by the archaea. You know, John James Bond never said, never say never, so I suppose, as far as I'm aware, there's never been a case of an archaea causing a human infection. That's the second kingdom. Once we get, after the next slide or two, we're going to forget about the archaea, except you will have, it might show up in a quiz or an exam, but beyond that, we're not going to talk about archaea in the rest of the course, because they're irrelevant to medical microbiology, but you need to know they exist. Okay. Now, eukaryotes, as I said, are the other cell-based life form, and I want to stress: bacteria are cells. You know, some people some non-bacteriologists seem to forget that they're actually cells. They are cells. They're just different cells. Eukaryotes are the other cell-based life form, and again, plants, animals, and I stress fungi and parasites. Okay, prokaryotic cells versus eukaryotic cells. Oftentimes people will just dismiss bacteria and say they're simple cells. That's a very real, that really is a gross oversimplification. Let's really go a little further and say what we really mean by this. Because in some ways they are simpler, but in some ways they're more complicated. Let's take a look at this. First of all, they are not compartmentalized. There are a lot of membranes in eukaryotic cells. The mitochondria, everything is made up of membranes. Mitochondria are membranous structures. The rough endoplasmic reticulum and its associated Golgi bodies are membranous. The Golgi bodies themselves are membranous. Basically, the nuclear membrane in eukaryotic cells is a membrane. None of these membranes are found in bacteria. Now, of course, there's got to be one membrane there, and that is the cell membrane, because by definition, that's what makes a cell, the fact that it's surrounded by a membrane. So there has to be a cell membrane. But beyond that, and we'll talk a little bit about the complications of bacteria, not just the simplicity in a minute. But the internal structures, the membranous structures that are present in eukaryotic cells, are not found in bacterial cells. Also, sterols are found commonly, such as cholesterol, in the cell membranes of eukaryotic or higher cells. Bacterial cells generally lack sterols. There is a single circular chromosome. The amount of this, the size of a bacterial cell is much smaller than a higher cell, and the genetic information that is contained therein is considerably less genes in a bacterial cell. And whereas higher cells may contain multiple chromosomes, there's only one in bacterial cells. There can be multiple copies, but there's only one type. The ribosomes are quite different in bacteria. Now, I want to stress, all the things that happen in higher cells have to happen in bacterial cells. We're not talking here about sort of eukaryotic cells coming from Mars and sort of bacterial cells coming from Venus. These are the same processes happen in these different cells. It's just that bacterial cells have to be able to do everything that higher cells do. But they may do it in a slightly different way in some instances because they don't have membranes. But they have to do everything. And for example, they have to carry out protein biosynthesis. It turns out that the ribosomes of bacteria, the term S is written down in the handout, S stands for Svedberg units. A simple way to think about it is size. But anyway, the ribosomes are 70S. They're smaller than the ribosomes in higher cells. The subunits are, instead of being 40 and 60S, they're 30S and 50S. The actual subunits are smaller. Within the ribosomal subunits, one of the important things involved in protein biosynthesis is the ribosomal RNA. The ribosomal RNA is also smaller in bacteria. It is 16 as opposed to 18S. And the other largest ribonucleic acids are also smaller than in higher cells. So the ribosomes are different in bacteria. That's one difference in prokaryotic cells versus eukaryotic cells. Okay. Now, so that's the first thing. Now, I want to look, just very briefly, I'm going to discuss the differences between bacteria or true bacteria versus archaea or archaebacteria. And there are so many different terms that are out there and variations thereon. I try to use different terms in different places to try and familiarize you with them. But basically, the true bacteria are the ones that cause human disease. The archaea or the archaebacteria are the other kingdom. Eubacteria or true bacteria have a peptidoglycan, which sometimes is called a murine. And there are a lot of different interesting things about the cell wall peptidoglycan. We're going to have a whole lecture on the cell wall as such. That's lecture number 4. So I'm going to just touch on it in this lecture, the next lecture, a little bit. But don't worry, you have a whole lecture on it coming, so that's okay. But there's a lot of unique things about the cell wall peptidoglycan of bacteria. One of the which is this unusual sugar, muramic acid. And we became good friends over the years, muramic acid. Because muramic acid is a sugar that's quite unique in nature. And actually, it was primarily from our research. It was shown to be quite unique in nature and not found in other sort of cells at all. So it's a marker for bacteria. The archaebacteria, on the other hand, have what's called a pseudomurine. And it's different in structure than the peptidoglycan. And I don't propose to go into a lot of... I'll do some chemistry when we need it. I actually like chemistry, but I also realize that it has its place. The pseudomurine is just... Let's just leave it at that. It's different. We don't need to know any more than that about it. It's different from the peptidoglycan. And there is particularly no muramic acid. There are other features that make archaea different. We'll talk a little bit about that in a second. The main thing, though, that this is what the Nobel Prize was all about... Woese got it, so it wasn't that long ago, actually. I don't remember the exact year. But anyway, the 16S RNA is present in all of the prokaryotes, the bacteria and the archaebacteria. The 16S, this is a bit, sometimes I get a bit too short on slides, but the 16S RNA is actually very useful for discriminating bacterial species. But as a group, it's quite different within the two kingdoms. Okay? But the 16S RNA has variable regions and conserved regions, and it's useful and we'll talk about that in the next lecture, on my diagnostics lecture. We'll talk a little more about that, but it's very useful for discriminating among bacteria and classifying bacteria, period. That is one of the things that's revolutionized modern bacteriology over the last 15, 20 years or so. Okay, so returning to what I just said in words, let's look at it pictorially. This is a eukaryotic cell. I've drawn the membrane in blue. You'll see that there's a membrane here and I'm going to point out now, by the way, this stops the archaea. I don't think I mention archaea again after this. I could be lying to you, or maybe I've made a mistake, but if I do, it might show up one more time, I don't know. But we aren't really going to discuss the archaea after this. So anyway, this is now, we're talking, this is eukaryotic versus prokaryotic cell, but I'm beginning to now to focus on the true bacteria, and I'm introducing the terms gram-positive and gram-negative here, which are the two major divisions within the bacteria of medical interest. Okay, so first of all, the eukaryotic cell has a cell membrane, and it doesn't matter if it's a gram-positive prokaryotic cell or a gram-negative prokaryotic cell. It's got to have a cell membrane, because by definition, again, that's what makes a cell a cell. In the case of, now this here's an example, and we're talking about the inside of the cell. Yes, it is true. The eukaryotic cell is more complicated. There are these membranous mitochondria. We have these ribosomes on an endoplasmic reticulum. There's a nuclear membrane. There are all sorts of membranes in eukaryotic cells. But yes, so that is true. The bacterial cell, on the other hand, is referred to as a nucleoid rather than a nucleus because there is no nuclear membrane. There is no mitochondria. However, what happens inside the cell happens at the cell membrane surface in bacteria in terms of carrying out oxidative phosphorylation, which is mainly what mitochondria are used for. So everything that has to be done in these eukaryotic cells has to be done in bacterial cells as well. I showed you something in red here. These are the storage granules, some of which are quite unique to bacteria. Some aren't. We'll talk about that again later too. You'll notice, however, that on the outside of the cell, simplicity goes away because bacteria can live in the environment, which can be quite nasty in terms of heat, in terms of drying out and what have you, in terms of UV light. So bacteria have to protect themselves, when they spread from one person to another, it doesn't happen by magic. It goes through the air, or it goes through the water supply, through the food. Bacterial pathogens have to be able to protect themselves in the environment. They also have to be able to protect themselves from the host immune system. So bacterial cells are quite, the envelope of at the outside of bacterial cells is very complicated, much more complicated than mammalian cells. So it's a fair statement to make that they are simple internally, but it's not a fair statement to make in terms of the cell envelope. And that's why we're going to have a whole lecture on the cell envelope, because there's a lot to discuss. Okay, you'll note I will get more into this as we go along. You'll note in gram-negative bacteria that there are three membranes. Three layers. This gray layer is the capsule, which is not really considered part of the cell envelope. The reason it's not considered part of the cell envelope is because the cell envelope consists of layers that are there all the time. They don't just go away, except in weird circumstances. But generally, if a bacterial cell has a certain cell envelope structure with these three layers in the case of gram-negatives and two layers in the case of gram-positives, that's the way it is. Capsules, on the other hand, for example, if you grow bacteria in the laboratory, even if they have a capsule, they will probably stop making that capsule after you've been growing them for a while. Also, some species don't even make capsules. So capsules are considered something that's not really part of the cell envelope. It's something that the organism may have and it may not. They're very important in some instances. And we will give quite a few examples where capsules are very important, and we will discuss those when we get to those specific organisms. Okay? So some of the things I'm showing you here are invariant. Some of them can be variable. And we will talk about this variation as we go along. And we also need to recognize that the Gram stain is simply a stain. It's a simple stain that when you stain an organism, it either stains or it doesn't stain. Well, that doesn't absolutely reflect the underlying structures of these organisms. And there's a whole group of organisms, the acid fast bacteria that we're going to talk about later, that don't fall into this category at all. And so we'll get to those again in lecture four, and we'll cover it when we discuss the mycobacteria, carinibacteria, and you'll get Nicardia under the fungi. We'll talk about that later. Okay, so you've got the point. Now, as regards the DNA, bacteria contain DNA not just on their chromosomes, but in addition to chromosomes, they can have pieces of circular DNA that can be transmitted between bacteria. And sometimes it doesn't just get transmitted between strains within a species. It can actually get transmitted among closely related species, and worse than that, sometimes even between not so closely related species. Why do we care? We care a lot. Because these things code for pathogenesis factors, and they also code for antibiotic resistance factors. To take an example, Bacillus anthracis has two plasmids, and my wife will be talking a lot about this later, so I'm not going to steal her thunder. But there are two virulence plasmids in Bacillus anthracis, the causative agent of anthrax. There are actually pneumonic strains of a related organism, Bacillus cereus, which is generally thought of as a food poisoning organism. But if it picks up, and they do sometimes pick up some of these one of the virulence plasmids from Bacillus anthracis, then it becomes a pneumonic strain. So, you know, it's not a theoretical thing. Antibiotics resistance factors, unfortunately, quite commonly do get transmitted among organisms. And there's been a fear, for example, that some of the antibiotics resistant factors in streptococci, the enterococci specifically, may spread to the staphylococci. We're really afraid of MRSA at the moment, methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus, that you'll hear about later, with good reason. Okay, so plasmids, and there are, you know, are extra chromosomal DNA. They can be a multiple copy number, and they can code for other things too, but they particularly code for pathogenesis factors and antibiotics resistance factors. And they're also involved in bacterial replication, and that will be discussed by Dr. Buchholz in a few lectures down the road. Okay, so coming back to what I said, the cell envelope that consists of cell membranes and cell wall components, there are three in gram-negative bacteria, the inner cell membrane, the cell wall peptidoglycan layer, and the outer membrane. There are two in gram-positive bacteria, the cell membrane and the peptidoglycan layer. The Gram stain is the fundamental stain that we have to know about. There are many stains for bacteria to do. We can do all sorts of wonderful things with different stains, but the fundamental stain is the Gram stain, which is a stain used so we can look under the microscope and see whether organisms are gram-positive or gram-negative. And it reflects the underlying cell envelope structure. And I will get more into that in the second lecture today. So that seems a little vague there. It's purposely a little vague. Because what I'm trying to do is introduce some concepts, and as we move along, build on those concepts, rather than just throw the whole lot at you in one go and say good luck. Okay, so that's the idea. So we're just introducing terms at the moment, and we're going to get into more details as we go along. That's the way this works. So come back to what I said about the lack of membranous structures. Oxidative phosphorylation, many bacteria will carry out oxidative phosphorylation. You've had this in earlier biochemistry courses. You may have chosen to forget about it, but I know you've all had it before. Oxidative phosphorylation in bacteria, which is involved in how we store energy from sugar metabolism, is carried out at the cell membrane in bacteria. Also, the cell wall, which is outside the cell membrane, as again makes bacteria more complicated than, for example, human cells. Not all eukaryotic cells are that simple. Plants, for example, have a cell wall. Fungi have a cell wall. But it has absolutely nothing whatsoever to do with the bacterial cell wall. They are totally different in composition. And the issue is, and what we're particularly concerned in this course, this is not a plant microbiology course. This is a medical microbiology course, okay? So we're concerned about differences between bacteria and mammalian cells. I'm not worried about plant cell wall structures. Those of you who want to go read up on your own, that's great. But I personally couldn't care less about plants. Sorry. Okay. The fungal part of the course is not being taught so much from a structural point of view, but I want to stress again, fungi are not bacteria, and yes, they do have a cell wall, and again, the cell, so not surprisingly, their eukaryotes has got nothing to do with the cell wall of bacteria. They're totally different in structure. The cell wall in bacteria is designed to help the bacteria survive the harsh conditions of living inside a host, or worse, in the environment. Because the bacterial cell is full of, among other things, salts, and there's a high osmotic pressure inside the cell that pushes on the cell membrane. And if there wasn't a cell wall there, if bacteria are put in a circumstance where they're, for example, in water, where there's not a lot of salt around, if there was no cell wall, then they would burst. The pressure on the inside would cause the cell to burst. So that is one reason why bacteria have a cell wall, so that they can survive in different circumstances in the environment where they're transmitted between one person and another. I'm talking about those of medical interest, where they're transmitted in the environment so they can survive adverse environmental conditions. Okay, I'm going to just touch on this now, because we're going to have a whole lecture on this later. And I'm just going to introduce the different structures. I'm not going to say a lot about the details of what they are, and I'm not going to say a lot about what they do. If I do that, then I won't have anything to say in my third lecture, and that would be really boring to stand here and have nothing to say. You know. So I'm going to leave that till my third lecture, okay? So we're going to talk about gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. Now, as I've said already, a gram stain is a simple stain. You simply throw some stuff on these bacteria. I'll get into the details in lecture two. You throw some stuff on these bacteria, they either stain or they don't. That's a pretty simple thing to do. Well, bacterial biochemistry is not simple. And underneath this gram-positive, and what I've tried to do whenever I can, I've tried to use a blue, or purple, I've tried to make the gram-positive blue, and I've tried to use a pink color when I say use the term gram-negative, because that's the colors that you see with a gram stain. So I'm going to try and reinforce that. There's a reason for these colors there. But anyway, the gram-positive stain reflects a particular structure often. The gram-negative stain reflects a particular structure. As I've said already, there is a cell membrane and there is a cell wall layer in the case of gram-positive bacteria. You'll notice other terms have been introduced. The term lipotychoic acid, which you'll see is coming out of the membrane. We've introduced the term peptidoglycan, the unique cell wall components which are found in both gram-positive and, hopefully it's marked, well anyway, it looks the same, gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria, this blue thing here. You'll see that there are tychoic acids which can be covalently bound to the peptidoglycan in gram-positive. There's no tychoic acid down here. You'll see, as we pointed out, there's an outer membrane in gram-negative bacteria. We don't use the term outer membrane when it comes to gram-positive because there is no outer membrane. We just use the term cell membrane or cytoplasmic membrane or periplasmic membrane, any of those synonyms that may be used. But the point is that the terms inner and outer membrane only apply to gram-negative bacteria. And you'll note that it doesn't, even just looking at it, just looking at the colors and the shapes, that the outer membrane doesn't look anything like the inner membrane. And that is absolutely true. The outer membrane is as different as night and day from other cell membranes. This cell membrane is just made up of phospholipids and proteins like any other cell membrane that you would find in any other cell. The outer membrane of gram-negative bacteria contains unique things. It contains lipopolysaccharides, purines, the Braun lipoprotein. And yes, I'm not defining them. We'll get into that later. All I want to make the point at this stage is these things are as different as night and day. And it usually correlates with the gram stain. There are exceptions. We'll give some examples of that as we go through this course. But generally speaking, the gram stain correlates with the gram structure. Okay, but they're not the same thing. Okay. Again, I'm trying to do this. I may have fouled here and now and again, so I apologize. But I've started to make, when we use the term gram negative, put the thing in pink. And when you look at gram-positive bacteria, put it in blue. The colour that we see is on the gram stain, blue or purple for gram-positive bacteria on gram staining, pink when we stain bacteria with gram-negative bacteria. In gram-negative bacteria, the outer membrane is the major permeability barrier. There is a space between the inner and outer membranes. Now, we've got to think about this. This is a three-dimensional thing. We're talking about, if we take the case of a spherical bacterial cell, and some of them are spherical, think of it as a ball. Okay, this, you know, we show things as cross sections, as one dimensional, but this is a ball. And basically it's a ball that's got, you know, it's got two or three outside layers. It's a three-dimensional structure. So there's a space in between these layers in gram-negative bacteria, and that's referred to as the periplasmic space. And it's not just a gap, it's not just a hole. You know, it's there for a reason. And there are particularly degradative enzymes that are stored in the periplasmic space in between the outer membrane and the cell membrane layer. The peptidoglycan layer has a lot of holes in it. It's not a membrane, it's a wall. And it has a lot of holes in it, and so it's not really much of a barrier to anything. But it's there for different reasons. The gram-positive bacteria don't have a periplasmic space. There's a shock. If we don't have an outer membrane, how could there be a periplasmic space? Okay. So if we start to understand these structures, we don't have to memorize some things. It's obvious. Okay. There cannot be a periplasmic space in gram-positive bacteria. Okay. So looking at this visually, again, we're showing the same thing I just showed you just now for gram-negative bacteria. Here is the space in between the outer membrane and the inner membrane with the cell wall in between. As I said already, membranes are basically made up of phospholipids. In the case of the outer membrane, they're a little more complicated. They have some other sorts of molecules present that have the same characteristics of having hydrophilic and hydrophobic portions. But the bottom line is membranes stick together. If you throw oil on water, it doesn't mix. Okay, membrane. That's the function of a membrane. The things just stick together and separate it from the usually aqueous environment. The peptidoglycan, on the other hand, is a covalent structure, and it's not a membrane at all. It's pieces of sugars and amino acids, peptides, glycan chains held together by covalent bonds. And there are plenty of holes, there are plenty of pores in the peptidoglycan layer. So it's not really considered a barrier at all. It does have, in the case of gram-positive bacteria, because it's so thick, it does have some characteristics of impeding things passing through it. But it's not really considered a barrier as such. The outer membrane of gram-negative bacteria, that's one of its major functions, is to basically help the cell decide what it wants to take up and what it doesn't want to take up. It's not just an issue of it's a sort of a set process. There are circumstances where, for example, there may be noxious substances outside that cell, and the outer membrane is going to help the cell avoid taking those things up. On the other hand, it may well want to uptake foodstuffs such as sugars and amino acids, and the function of the outer membrane is to be able to do this. Again, we'll get into this in more detail later. The major issue of this slide I want to point out is the structure, the three layers, and these degradative enzymes can be stored within this space. They can be secreted. But you have the bacteria have a choice here. There's no choice when it gets to gram-positive bacteria. There's no choice at all. Interesting, my numbers disappeared. Okay, never mind. The gram-positive cell envelope, in this instance, the degradative enzymes, if they're produced, they have to be excreted. There's no choice about it. And they could be things like, and bacterial toxins are often degradative enzymes. We'll have a whole lecture on including particularly exotoxins, protein poisons, and endotoxins, which are not protein poisons. Okay, so degradative enzymes and other proteins and what have you, there's no choice about it. There's nowhere to keep them. There's no periplasmic space. Now, I've used the word some here purposely because bacteria, some bacteria are motile. They can actually move from one place to another. It isn't essential. if you've got bacteria in a pool of water, I mean, they're gonna float around anyway. I mean, they don't need flagella to move in a liquid. They're gonna, you know, move with or without flagella. They're gonna move. By the same token, if a bacterial cell is in an infection and it's picked up by a macrophage, that macrophage is going to transfer it, and if it isn't killed, and many pathogens aren't killed by macrophages and polymorphic nuclear cells, they're going to be transported around the body anyway. So there's no requirement that bacteria have flagella. Some have that advantage, in that they have the opportunity that they are actually motile. I'm going to mention it in some cases, and some I'm probably not. I'm going to mention it when I consider it's important, okay? But there's something you need to know about, that bacteria can be flagellated. It's particularly important, for example, in terms of the enterohemorrhagic E. coli, because it's one of the ways we know, that, which is the most important among the diseases caused by E. coli, and they are important causes of food poisoning. So flagella, we mention it there. But most of the time, I'm not going to say a lot about flagella, because they aren't very important for what we're talking about. Some bacteria are motile. The locomotory organelles are the flagella. They actually do taste the environment. I've given more detail in the handout. There's a very complex process, which is well defined, by which bacteria are actually able to sense their environment. They can tell whether, if it's something they consider obnoxious, nasty, they'll move away from it. If it's something like a foodstuff that they're interested in, they'll actually move towards it. They'll move along a chemical gradient, and that is referred to as chemotaxis. Okay, so not, again, that's the key word there, some. Not all bacteria have flagella. And again, I stress what I'm doing today in this one lecture is giving you an overview of all bacteria, which includes two kingdoms and every organism that affects human beings, which is probably the order of important ones, perhaps 50 or so organisms, but there are many species can occasionally cause human disease. I'm giving you an overview, okay? So not all bacteria have flagella. Some have flagella. Flagella are embedded in the cell membrane. That's what this shows. And they project as a strand. It's not shown in this particular slide. I'll show you an electron micrograph in a later lecture, which gives you some measure of really what flagella really look like. But this is just a portion of it. It's cut off here. They actually extend out from the cell. They're long filaments. They're particularly made up, we talk about flagella being made up of flagellin, this part of the major part of the flagella are made up by a flagellin. This is actually basically a motor, and it actually can sort of physically turn these flagella and cause them to rotate. And so of course there's not just one protein, a motor is not that, it doesn't matter if it's a biochemical motor or if it's a mechanical motor, they're not that simple, there are components. Okay, so I'm not saying that flagella are just made up of one protein. But the major component, the strand, is made up of the vast bulk of the flagella, made up of single protein, flagellin. Okay? And this motor moves the cell by a propeller-like motion. And that's what a propeller does. It actually rotates. And this is how these things work. Okay? A propeller-like action. Now, in a few cases, and particularly we're going to talk about the spirochetes, and I will bring this up again later. There's a whole half a lecture on spirochetes, which includes the organisms that cause syphilis, the third most important sexually transmitted disease, and Borrelia burgdorferi, one of the major causes of arthritis. These are spirochetes. They have a similar function to flagella, and actually biochemically they're quite similar, but they don't act by a propeller-like action. Instead of sort of sticking out at 90 degrees or that sort of angle from the cell, they actually run lengthwise. And so what you see is a snake-like motion in this instance. Okay, so axial filaments are a specialized form of flagella that we primarily see within spirochetes. Okay, making wall-less forms. All right, I've tried really hard to get this one as clear as I can get it over the years, because it can be very confusing. So if you don't get it now, I'll do my best. But if you don't, sit down on your own and read it carefully, because we're going to talk about four different things, I think, here. Okay, first of all, some bacteria, you can make bacteria wall-less. There are two primary ways of making bacteria wall-less. One is to treat with an enzyme that degrades the cell wall. The other one is to treat with an antibiotic that inhibits cell wall biosynthesis, because I've said already that the cell wall protects the bacteria from being lysed in circumstances where there's low salinity in the environment or in the liquid that they're surrounded by. However, in the laboratory, for example, if you put bacteria in a solution at a high salt concentration, appropriate salt concentration, you lyse the cell wall, the bacteria may not totally explode or fall apart as they would under other circumstances. The same thing can happen in the human body in some cases. So the first point is, usually these, when we make wall-less bacteria, they're not viable. Unfortunately, that's not always the case. In some cases, when you treat, for example, a patient with penicillin, it might be a patient, for example, who has gonorrhea. It might be a patient who has pneumonia caused by Streptococcus pneumoniae. In a few cases, not often, but it happens. The antibiotic will cause the organism to stop making a cell wall. But the organism happens to have a tough enough membrane that they don't fall apart. The osmotic pressure doesn't cause the bacterial cell to explode. Now, we're separating here. So first of all, we need to separate wall-less bacteria that don't replicate from wall-less bacteria that do. As I said, most of the time, wall-less bacteria don't replicate. Okay, and then we have, surprise, surprise, we have two terms. Spheroplasts would be coming from gram-positive bacteria because they don't have an outer membrane. Gram-negative bacteria when they have an outer membrane. And protoplasts, when there's no outer membrane, that would be gram-positive bacteria. Okay, so there are different terms used for when you make a wall-less form of the organism from a gram-positive or a gram-negative organism. There's different terms. Spheroplasts and protoplasts are the two terms that you need to know. Now, in the case of an infection, when the organism is in the case we get unlucky and these bacteria can actually replicate, they're referred to as L forms. Okay, so you need to understand the concept of how you can make wall-less bacteria. And there are three consequences, two where they don't replicate and one where they do. Now, in this instance here, we're starting with the same organism. If it was a streptococcus at the beginning, it's a streptococcus at the end. If it was Neisseria, a gram-negative organism at the beginning, it's still a Neisseria. It doesn't make any difference if it's an L form or not. It hasn't changed its species just because it can't make a wall. We need to understand that, again, as we start to get into the complexity, into the details now, as we begin to go through this course, we need to recognize that there are some bacteria that don't make cell walls. The one in particular that is of medical importance are the mycoplasma and related organisms. They don't make a cell wall, ever. It's not a case of we treat them with something and they don't make a cell wall. They don't make a cell wall, period. They don't have the genes that code for the production of a cell wall. They just don't make cell walls. And don't confuse the term mycoplasma with mycobacteria. They have absolutely nothing to do with each other, other than the fact that the word mic at the beginning of the word. The mycobacteria are nothing to do with mycoplasma. They are the prototype acid-fast bacteria, which is a totally different class of bacteria that we're going to talk about later. And yes, it's very common for medical students to confuse mycobacteria and mycoplasma because they sound alike. They've got nothing to do with each other, okay? All right, you'll have a whole lecture on mycoplasmas and ureaplasmas and what have you from somebody else later on. I've forgotten who it is. Well, it's definitely not me. And I will lecture on the mycobacteria, okay? All right. Another thing we need to know about bacteria is bacteria can produce what's called pili, singular pilus. Fimbriae is actually the same thing. It's just, I don't know why some people chose to call them one thing and some people chose to call them something else. But anyway, pili and fimbriae are the same thing. These are hair-like projections coming out from the cell membrane that poke out through the cell, out into the exterior. They've got nothing to do with flagella. Flagella, the locomotory organelles, pili are much shorter generally. Sometimes they're just a fuzz in some organisms, but they're projections from the cell. They're often involved in sexual conjugation, and they're often involved in adhesion to the host epithelium. We'll talk about pili in a few cases, but we're not going to discuss it in every organism. We'll discuss it when it's important, okay? I've already mentioned about capsules, and I'm going to also talk about slime layers at the same time. Capsules are considered to not be part of the cell envelope. The cell envelope consisting of the cell membrane, the outer membrane if it's present, and the cell wall or peptidoglycan layer. Capsules are an additional structure that is made by many pathogenic bacteria, and some non-pathogenic bacteria for that matter. They're particularly involved in protecting the cell, in stopping nasty things coming into contact with the cell envelope. So they're outside the cell envelope. If they're well-defined, they're referred to as a capsule. If they're not well-defined, they're referred to as a slime layer, or a term that was more recently introduced, probably because it sounds sexy, I don't know. But glycocalyx, it's the same thing. A slime layer based in a glycocalyx is just a sort of a copious, thick secretion of capsule, and it's particularly involved in forming things. Some bacteria will actually grow on things like catheters, and they grow in sort of microcolonies, and these slime layers enable this to happen. They're almost always polysaccharide. You will hear about the polydglutamic acid capsule, which is a polypeptide, from my wife in the case of Bacillus anthracis and related organisms. But generally speaking, with that exception, polysaccharides are almost always, sorry, capsules and slime layers are almost always made of polysaccharides. And as I've said a short while ago, they're often lost during in vitro culture when you grow them in the laboratory. However, in vivo, in the body, or in that matter in tissue culture, in macrophages and neutrophils, they're protective. And we'll talk about how they protect when we get into my pathogenesis lecture, which now I'm going to introduce the clinical part of the course. Okay, I probably wouldn't have bothered much with endospores in the past, and we may not in the future. I'm sure its interest will also start to dissipate. But we've all heard so much about spores since 2002 with the attack on the postal system, the so-called Amerithrax attack. There are spores. Most bacteria do not make spores. Let me make that absolutely clear. I mean, those of you who read the newspapers and watch TV a lot may get the idea that bacteria generally make spores. They don't. Most bacteria do not make spores. There are only, among the pathogenic bacteria, there are really only two genera, the bacilli and the clostridia, that make spores, okay? So don't get it fixed inside your head that because you've heard it so much about spores and bacteria. I will bring it up again later, some more details in lecture three. Okay, these aren't the dormant form of the cell. For example, there was some work done about 50 years ago in a place called Grignard Island off of Scotland, where the British Army was carrying out some field trials with anthrax spores. It took them 50 years to clean up the island because they just couldn't get rid of it. These spores will survive for hundreds of years. Spores are, when it says dormant, that's what it means. They're dormant, and they will just, it's really hard to get rid of them once they're there. They're produced when the organism is starved. They are resistant to adverse conditions, particularly high temperatures, which you'll find in the environment a lot. Usually spores don't get exposed to organic solvents, but they are resistant to organic solvents, which is why it's one of the reasons it's so hard to get rid of them, because they're just resistant to most organic solvents, unlike other bacteria, which would be killed by them. The only reason I bring this up is because this is something that's unique to bacterial spores. Calcium dipicolinate, or dipicolinic acid is the acid name for it. This is the salt name for it. And it's only found in bacterial spores. It isn't found anywhere else in nature. Okay, so that's why it's brought up. It's characteristic of spores. Again, there will be discussion in this course of other bacilli and clostridia later on, but these are the typical spores I'm talking about here. You may hear this word spore-like later on in another case, but these are the typical well-defined spore-forming organisms of bacilli and the clostridia. Okay, let's have a few minutes break. We'll get going again on the dot at 11 o'clock, and we'll have a lecture on diagnosis in the clinical microbiology laboratory.